In this week's On My Shelf, I'm sharing about two nonfiction books that were gripping reads, The Value of Reading Critically, Why Every Parent Needs a Little Time Off, The Overwhelming Nature of Revising Manuscripts, and My Family's Experience with a Show Called Signing Time. If you've been around On My Shelf for a while, you probably know that I like to read pretty widely. That means not only do I read fiction and poetry, but I also enjoy memoir and nonfiction. I read almost as much nonfiction as I do fiction. Part of it is because I love to learn, but part of it is also because I used to be a journalist and I'm partial to books written by journalists. That doesn't mean that I only read nonfiction books written by journalists. It just means that as a former journalist, I really love gathering information on whatever topic happens to interest me at the moment. So I recently read Devil in the Grove, Thurgood Marshall, The Groveland Boys, and The Dawn of a New America by Gilbert King. Devil in the Grove won the Pulitzer Prize in 2013. It's a fascinating look at a civil rights case that involved four young men who were accused of raping a white girl. Those boys became known as the Groveland Boys, and Thurgood Marshall, known as Mr. Civil Rights, became their lawyer. It's a story of danger and justice and hope, too, because Marshall was an important piece in bringing about a new America. The book is exciting and entertaining and compelling. History isn't always easy to read, but this one was. Another fantastic nonfiction book I recently read for the second time was Catherine Boo's Behind the Beautiful Forevers, Life, Death, and Hope in a Mumbai Undercity. This book. It was written so compellingly, I could hardly put it down. At times, it was hard to remember that it was a book of nonfiction. Catherine Boo weaves a story around so many different characters, and readers will begin to care about those characters, and then she opens up tragedy and circumstance, and ends it all with hope. It's not easy to read about things like a Mumbai Undercity, but Catherine Boo makes it accessible to even the most tender-hearted reader. At the time of release, one book review said Behind the Beautiful Forevers was reported like Watergate, written like Great Expectations, and handily the best international nonfiction in years. I couldn't have said it any better. You might have noticed that many of the books on my list this year are award winners. That's because I decided when the year began that I wanted to study the award-winning fiction and nonfiction. I don't mean just read them. I wanted to study them. I wanted to find out what the authors did that made these award-winning books. I wanted to become so familiar with their techniques and their language and their plots and their details that I could turn around and maybe write a book that could make a difference or change more lives because it was the absolute best I had to offer. I started a book blog where I analyze a lot of these books that I'm reading, fiction more than nonfiction, because I'm not in a place where I can write a nonfiction book like Devil in the Grove or Behind the Beautiful Forevers, because it takes time and research, and time and research aren't easy to do with six young kids. But I do plan to write one eventually. I love research. I love bringing to light something that is largely hidden from the public. I love using my journalism training to help change the world too. My book blog looks at language and characters and plot lines and humor and emotion and pacing and all of the elements of a good book. As I'm reading a book, I keep a notebook with me at all times. I jot down page numbers and paragraphs of passages that stick out as great. I include a little note about why I liked it or what made it work in my mind. It's been a completely different reading experience for me. And you might wonder, what's the point of that? Well, what analyzing books, especially these award winners, has done for me is it has flooded me with ideas about how to write better books and characters and plots and even essays. But it's not just that. It's made me appreciate books to an even greater degree. When I'm jotting down these notes, I'm appreciating what it is the author did well enough for me to take notice. So much of the time I speed through books without noticing the effort it took to produce a sentence so beautiful. Now I always notice. It's been a little while since my husband and I have taken a vacation from our kids. It sounds funny to say it like that, but you know what? As parents, it's really important to take time away. My husband and I always try to get at least a kidless weekend in every quarter. But we're coming up on about 6 months, and we can tell. Our tempers are shorter, our thresholds are lower, our attitudes need a little work. I love my children so very much, but the reality is every parent needs a break every now and then. Parenting is one of the hardest jobs in the world. Raising little illogical people is maddening, and it's easy to get burned out. Breaks are my lifeline, whether they're date nights or weekends away or a whole week to spend with my husband. I encourage every parent to give themselves a little time off. I've got some book releases coming up really soon, so I've been madly trying to finish revisions and editing. I have a stack of 9 manuscripts that I'm trying to revise and edit, and it's been a little overwhelming lately, to say the least. But I'm slowly getting through them, and by far the hardest thing about the revising and editing process is writing a book description. It's so hard to write a book description for your own books. It's necessary, of course, because how will people know what your book is about without a description? But it's definitely not easy. Mostly because I have to completely switch gears and try to sell myself. I don't like selling myself. But you know what? Selling yourself is something you have to get really good at if you want to make it in any business. We have to sell ourselves in email newsletters, or in social media content, or in book descriptions. It doesn't matter how many of these I've written, it still doesn't get any easier. I can write a great book description for anyone's book but my own. I guess that's just the way it goes. I suspect many business people feel like it's much easier to sell another person than it is to sell ourselves. I don't really have anything new on the watching side of things, except that my family and I have been watching this kids show called Signing Time. I have a nephew who is mostly deaf, and as he gets older, it becomes increasingly more difficult to communicate with him, so my family is taking steps to learn sign language. This show is great for teaching the basics, especially for children. The 9-year-old thinks it's a little tedious because it has a few cheesy songs, but it does what it is intended to do, which is teach. We have grand plans of proclaiming one day a week as a sign language day, where no one can speak unless it's in sign. This would not only help us to practice sign language, but it would also give my ears a break. If I don't want to listen to my boys, I could just close my eyes. Just kidding. But no, really. For more about me or my books, sign up for my email newsletter, where I share an inside look at life and projects I'm working on and the current novel of the year. If you have any questions about writing or books, or how I managed to run a writing career with 6 little ones, leave them in the comments and I'll get to them in future episodes. For more on my shelf, subscribe to my YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.